Warning: this content contains depictions of drugs and smoking. Discretion is advised.
Dreamscape presents Marvel's Spider-Man, Down These Mean Streets, by Keith R.A. DeCandido. Narrated by Tara Sands. 1. Peter Parker looked at the clock on the wall, smiled, and said, "We've got a few minutes, so let's go to the next chapter, the periodic table of elements." A room full of teenagers moaned and whined. Peter smiled, remembering hearing similar moans in science class when he was a student here at Midtown High School. And the teacher jumped ahead. Of course, Peter never indulged in those complaints himself. He was always three steps ahead of the rest of his classmates, especially in the science classes. Whether it was in physics, chemistry, biology, or the general sciences that he now, years later, was himself teaching. Now, he said chidingly. The periodic table was part of the reading you were supposed to have done by yesterday's class, so you all should have it down pat by now. He walked over to the side of the classroom, to the bulletin board, situated between the room's two doors on the right-hand side from where the kids sat. Besides, it's been up on the board all year.
Dude, I thought it was a movie poster,
Tommy Cialfi muttered. Several of the kids around him tried, and mostly failed, to swallow a laugh.
Well, it has been coming soon to a classroom near you.
Peter winced as he made the bad joke.
Why is it I'm hilarious when I'm beating up bad guys, but all the jokes I make as a teacher are lame?
All right. Who can tell me why the isotopes are in the order they're in?
He looked around the room. Only two hands, those of Marissa Blaustein and Susan Baptiste, went up.
Hardly surprising, Peter thought. They're two of the brightest kids in the class.
Marissa was pretty, popular, had perfect diction, and was on the junior varsity cheerleading squad. Susan was overweight, unpopular, spoke with a Haitian accent, and was in the chess club. Both were brilliant, and they seemed to be in competition with each other academically. Marissa couldn't stand the idea of the social misfit being better than her, and Susan despised Marissa for everything she stood for. Peter had to admit, it made for good theater. However, this was a ridiculously easy question, and one that anyone who had actually done the homework would know. So, he looked out over the class to see who besides these two really did the work. Actually, only a few were looking at him. Most of the 30 kids were studying either their notebooks, or the window, or the floor, or the clock in the hopes that it would move faster. Peter's freshman general sciences class was scheduled for last period. And it was always difficult to hold kids' attention during the final class of the day, particularly in a required class that most of them didn't give a damn about. Still, he was there to teach, and they were there to learn. He fixed his gaze on Javier Velasquez, the class's biggest troublemaker. Javier wasn't the only kid in the class with a rap sheet, but he was the one who took the most pride in it.
Javier.
What?
Peter exhaled.
Answer the question, please.
Knowing full well the kid hadn't heard it, since he hadn't paid attention to anything Peter had said all year, he threw Javier a bone and re-asked it.
What order are the isotopes on the periodic table in?
He shrugged.
Alphabetical?
One kid almost laughed, but stopped at a glare from Javier.
L doesn't usually come before B, Peter said. At least, not in any language I'm familiar with.
You familiar with the language of kiss my ass?
Peter grinned.
Yep, it's the language you'll be talking if you don't do your homework. Or if I decide to tell the principal about the switchblade you've got stashed in your locker.
The look on Javier's face was priceless. Normally, a kid talking to a teacher like that, or for that matter, carrying a weapon into the school, would get detention or a suspension. But Peter didn't much see the point in punishing Javier. He knew that Javier lived with the threat of getting shot or stabbed every day. Detention was going to neither scare him nor dissuade him from future infractions. Suspension would just put him back on the streets for a few days, and he might decide to make it permanent, in which case, nobody won. Peter looked around the room. Anyone else? Slowly, Gregory Horowitz raised a meek hand. Gregory had the highest grades of anyone in the class, but he rarely raised his hand, despite Peter's encouragement. Seeing this as a good sign, Peter called on him.
Atomic mass?
That's right.
Indignantly, Marissa said, No, it's not. The book says it's atomic weight. In a barely audible voice, Gregory said,
Scientists prefer the term atomic mass now.
In a stage whisper, Tommy said,
Ooh, geekery's hanging out with scientists now.
Actually, you're both right,
Peter said, overlaying Tommy.
Unfortunately, the textbook we're using is about 5 years old. Or to put it in simple terms, the same age that Tommy's acting.
That got a quick laugh from several kids, with the notable exceptions of Tommy and Javier.
And since then, as Gregory said, scientists have come to prefer the more precise term atomic mass to atomic weight.
Let's hear it for budget cuts, Peter thought with a sigh.
The text they were using wasn't much farther along than the one he had used as a 14-year-old. He pointed at the upper left-hand portion of the chart.
H is for hydrogen, which has an atomic mass of 1.00797, or just one for our purposes. How do you figure out the atomic mass, Marissa?
Since Marissa had obviously done the reading, Peter figured she'd give the right answer. Without hesitating, she confidently said,
By adding the number of neutrons and electrons.
Close. Susan?
With a triumphant look at her classmate, Susan said,
The number of neutrons and protons.
Marissa stared daggers at Susan.
Right. It's the particles in the nucleus that make up the atomic mass. The electrons orbit the nucleus and don't figure into it.
Tommy rolled his eyes.
Something bothering you, Tommy?
Shifting uncomfortably in his seat at the sudden attention, Tommy said,
No, Mr. Parker, it's just... Well, I mean, come on. Who gives a damn about this crap? Atomic weight, atomic mass, it don't mean nothing.
Peter sighed. When he took this job, he knew it was going to be an uphill struggle. Most of these kids would rather be playing with their Xboxes or chatting with their friends online or text messaging each other from across the room or whatever it was that kids did these days. Peter didn't even know what kids did when he was that age. He had been as much an outcast as Gregory and Susan were. The geek, the Dexter, the nerd, the one who went to a science exhibit instead of the football game or the homecoming dance.
And imagine what life would have been like if I hadn't gone to that science exhibit.
Looking out over the mostly apathetic faces of kids desperate to get out of school as fast as possible, he let out a long breath and walked back to the front of the class, away from the chart, and sat on the edge of his desk.
Look. I know this all seems meaningless, but look at what we're talking about here.
He pointed at the chart.
This is what everything's made of. You, me, the desk, your books, the pavement outside, the lockers, the trees, the SUVs, the buildings, your clothes, your cell phones, your video games. This is what it's all made out of. These are the building blocks of the world. How can you not be excited by that? Quickly holding up a hand, he said, "Don't answer that." Several chuckles followed. "I know you don't think this is a big deal, but it really is." He glanced at the clock. The bell would be ringing momentarily. "Any other questions?"
Ronnie Hammond raised his hand.
"Yes, Ronnie. KR stands for Krypton, right?"
Peter nodded.
"I thought that was a planet."
Before Peter could give that the answer it deserved, the bell rang.
"We'll pick this up tomorrow."
His words could barely be heard over the din of books and notebooks closing, desks sliding on the linoleum floor, and classmates talking to each other. Peter noted that Susan and Gregory weren't talking to anyone.
"There but for the grace of a radioactive spider go I," he thought wistfully. "And don't forget," he said louder, "there's a test on chapters 4, 5, and 6 on Friday."
That was met with predictable moans and whines. Javier was one of the last to get up. He stared at Peter the whole time, then got up and walked out, never taking his eyes off Peter. For his part, Peter met the stare. By the time he reached the door, Javier looked royally pissed off that Peter didn't blink.
Poor kid. If only he knew.
Peter looked like a wussy white guy from Queens, and Javier usually ate teachers like that for breakfast. But Peter had spent all of his life, since he was only a little older than Javier, dealing with people who would eat Javier for breakfast. Gregory made his way out of the class slowly, not wanting to get in anyone's way for fear that someone might notice him. Peter recognized that walk oh so well. That was how he had walked all over Midtown High. It was also how he had walked into that science exhibit on that fateful day, sponsored by a company in the Pacific Northwest that was doing demonstrations at high schools across the country. He had entered slowly, shuffling his feet, not wanting to bother anybody, and therefore had been stuck at the back of the room, barely able to see the demo. When a spider had gotten into the workings and became irradiated, Peter had been the one it bit in its death throes, the radiation changing the spider bite from something potentially fatal to something wondrous. Standing at the back as he was, nobody had noticed Peter stumbling out of the exhibit hall, wandering aimlessly down the streets of the Forest Hills section of Queens, wondering why he felt so strange. Now, Peter walked more confidently through the school's halls, preparing himself to head home to his wife. No, head home to an empty apartment, he amended. Mary Jane had rehearsal tonight. His lovely wife had a supporting part and was understudy to the female lead in a way-the-heck off-Broadway play called The Z-Axis.
"Hey, Mr. Parker."
Peter turned to see Tommy standing at his locker, wearing the same smart-aleck grin that Flash Thompson used to wear when he was about to torment young Peter Parker. Some of Tommy's friends were nearby, cleaning out their lockers and grabbing their jackets and books.
"Yeah, Tommy?"
To Peter's surprise, the grin fell, and Tommy sounded serious.
"That speech you gave today, I gotta say, it really, really, really sucked."
By the time he reached the last two words, the grin was back. Putting a hand on Tommy's shoulder, Peter said,
"Well, Tommy, under normal circumstances, I'd say that you just have to tough it out until June, at which point you'll never have to take general science again."
Tommy looked confused.
"What do you mean, normal circumstances?"
Peter smiled.
"Well, if you keep going the way you're going, You're gonna have to take it all over again in summer school after you flunk. Removing the hand and taking pleasure in the guffaws from Tommy's friends, Peter continued walking toward the faculty lounge. He entered the tiny room that served as the teacher's refuge from the students. The furniture was brand new when it was purchased shortly after World War II. The refrigerator sounded like a motorcycle with a muffler problem, and only intermittently kept its contents below room temperature. And the grout in the tilework around the sink could, at this point, qualify as an alien life form. Just remember, Parker, you chose this job. If nothing else, it provided a more steady income than freelance photography ever had.
How do you do it?
Peter turned to see one of the math teachers, Elizabeth Doyle, sitting on the green sofa with the red cushions, clutching a can of diet soda for dear life.
Do what, Liz?
Keep that smile on your face.
She shook her head. Damn newbies, always thinking this job's a calling and that it's noble. It's a job. And like every job, it sucks. Walking over to the coffee maker on the counter, Peter said,
Oh, believe me, Liz, I've been at jobs that suck.
He saw that there was about one cup left in the pot and reached for the handle with one hand while opening the cabinet to retrieve his mug with the other.
But here, at least I feel like I'm accomplishing something.
Liz looked at him like he'd grown another head.
If you say so, don't you have Velasquez in your class?
Peter nodded as he poured the coffee into the mug, steam twirling up from it. She shook her head.
That's an expulsion waiting to happen. I'm telling you, the only way he's not expelled by the end of the year is if he gets himself killed.
Whatever Peter was going to say in response was lost when he made the mistake of actually drinking the coffee. Closing his eyes and trying not to think too hard about what he was doing, he swallowed it.
I see they're still using yesterday's dishwater for the coffee.
Holding up her can, Liz said,
That's why I stick with the soda machines. Safer.
Yeah.
Peter poured the rest of the coffee into the sink.
I can always grab a cup at home before going on patrol.
Anyhow, I think it's important. Liz held up a hand.
I swear, Pete, you tell me you took this job to give something back to the school that taught you so much, I will throw up right here on this sofa.
Peering at the cushions, Peter smiled and said,
Might improve the color.
Shaking her head, Liz hauled herself up from the couch and drank down the rest of her soda.
You're a crazy man, Pete.
I think that was part of the job description when they hired me. Must have been crazy since the age of 18.
Liz chuckled. Sad, but true. You need a lift home?
Nah, I'll walk. Thanks, though.
Peter had accepted lifts home from Liz a few times, but with MJ not being home, he wasn't in any particular rush. The walk back to the apartment would help him decompress.
Smart man, no car in this town. Wouldn't have one myself, but you try getting to Bayside by mass transit from here.
Having spent most of his youth navigating the Queens bus lines, Peter felt Liz's pain. The only subway that came close to Bayside, the 7, didn't come through Forest Hills. She was definitely better off with a car, even the 86 Chevy Junker that she drove. After saying his goodbyes to Liz, Peter went by the science office to drop off his books and check his mail. Peter had spent most of his time since high school learning to travel with what he could put in his pockets. His school-related stuff remained in the science office. He didn't have anything to grade tonight, and he'd prepare for tomorrow's lessons in the morning. And everything else he needed fit in either his pants or jacket. It was a bit nippy out on this spring day, but Peter was wearing a skin-tight outfit underneath his button-down shirt, jacket, and slacks, so he figured he'd be warm enough. Bidding farewell to his fellow science teachers,
several of whom made their usual disparaging remarks about Peter's leaving all his work at the office. He headed toward the exit, allowing the teenagers dashing through the halls to get to their parents' cars or the bus stop or just out to zip past him. Among the many gifts the dying spider had conferred upon him was a sixth sense that he referred to as his spider sense, which allowed him to avoid danger. In practical terms, it meant that in a hallway full of high school kids desperate to be outside, not one of them crashed or bumped into Peter. The biggest buzz from that extra sense came just as Peter was approaching the metal door at the end of the hall and was about to push the horizontal bar in to release it. Stopping his forward motion and moving to the side gracefully, and so quickly that he doubted anyone would even notice, Peter avoided being rear-ended by Javier. For his part, Javier stumbled forward unsteadily, not even acknowledging Peter's presence. I was expecting another dirty look from him at the very least. Resolving to live with the disappointment, Peter followed Javier to the sidewalk. During the 1 hour after school let out, this side street was closed to vehicular traffic, except for the city buses that Midtown High commissioned to serve as shuttles to various neighborhoods. They were lined up, one in front of the other on the curb, kids milling toward the front doors, faculty proctors making a valiant and futile attempt to keep the students in some semblance of single file. Peter shuddered, knowing that he would catch this duty in 2 weeks and dreading it. Then he whirled back toward Javier, mainly because the spider sense buzz Peter got off the kid hadn't died down. In fact, it was intensifying.
Yo, Javier, sup with you, man?
Asked one of his friends. Peter didn't know the kid's given name, but had seen him before hanging out with Javier, who called him Nariz. Given the enormous schnoz on the kid, the nickname, the Spanish word for nose, fit. Nariz held up his hand, expecting Javier to clasp it in return. But Javier was just standing unsteadily in the middle of the sidewalk.
You gonna leave me hanging, yo?
With each passing second, Peter's spider sense buzz increased in intensity. Javier was wobbly on his feet, but he didn't move or speak. Just as Peter was about to find a place to change into his other outfit, Nariz lightly tapped Javier on the shoulder with the back of his hand.
Sup, yo, you dissing me now? What up with that? Get off of me!
Even as Javier said the words, he backhanded Nariz in the face. In and of itself, that would have been unremarkable. Except that the blow sent Nariz 20 feet down the sidewalk, knocking over a group of seniors who were congregating.
14-year-old kids don't usually have that kind of strength,
Peter thought, as he realized that he wasn't going to have time to change clothes. Especially when he saw that Javier's complexion had changed from its usual dark skin tone to an emerald green.
There's absolutely no way this can be good.
Super strength and green skin was a combination that generally meant enhancement by gamma radiation. The most spectacular example being the Hulk.
How does a street kid from Queens get gamma irradiated?
Peter asked himself, but saved it for later.
Maybe he got bitten by a radioactive wombat. Worry about that when he isn't about to tear up the street and the students.
One of the security guards at this door was a retired cop named Pat Lefty Lefkowitz, who'd been keeping an eye on things at Midtown High since before Peter's student days. Upon seeing Javier clock someone, he waddled over toward the kid, hand on the butt of his .38 revolver. Peter, hoping to keep this civil and knowing full well he probably couldn't, also moved toward Javier.
If nothing else, maybe I can keep Lefty's gun in its holster.
Hey, Velasquez, what'd I tell you about?
Javier turned around and snarled. His face was getting greener by the second, and Peter noticed that he was also growing, his new physique straining against his clothes.
Sweet Jesus!
Lefty cried and unholstered his revolver. Before he could fire a shot, Javier was on the retired cop, punching him in his huge belly, sending Lefty sprawling against the metal door, wheezing. Peter swore he heard the sound of bones cracking. Kids and faculty alike started screaming, but Peter tried not to pay attention to any of it. Grabbing Javier's arm, he whirled the kid around into one of the metal doors, hoping that his own super strength would give the push enough force to render the kid at least insensate for a few minutes, until one of the other guards showed up with a pair of handcuffs. Unfortunately, being smashed into a metal door served only to make Javier angry. "Kill you!" he cried as he jumped at Peter, who could only let Javier knock him to the ground, using his abilities to roll with the attack enough so that it only hurt a little when they collided with the pavement.
"Get off of him, Velasquez!"
Peter recognized the voice of the other security guard assigned to this door, an ex-jock with delusions of competence named Brian Klein. But Brian's words concerned Peter a lot less than Javier's face. He was as green as the Hulk now, and based on the way he'd slammed into Peter's ribcage, he was starting to get near the Hulk's strength class, too. Before Peter could kick Javier off him, and later come up with a feeble explanation for how a skinny white science teacher could toss a super strong kid around, Javier suddenly screamed as if he was in pain, rearing his head back and shouting at the clear sky. Then the kid collapsed right on top of Peter. Deciding discretion was the better part of keeping his secret safe. Peter played the helpless teacher and whimpered, help? Javier, now a dead weight on Peter's chest, started twitching. A moment later, the weight was gone as Brian had rolled him off. Clambering to his feet, Peter looked down to see the green hue fading from Javier's epidermis, even as the kid was convulsing. From the ground, Lefty said,
"I called 911.
Peter turned to see Lefty still on the ground, but holding a cell phone. He clambered to his feet, wincing in a manner Peter recognized as that of a man with cracked ribs.
"Good call, old-timer,"
Brian said. Lefty snapped,
"Don't call me old-timer, you little punk."
Lefty, Peter knew, had never had much use for Brian.
"You okay, Pete?"
Peter nodded. "Just a little winded." Brian stared at Peter.
"That was a brave thing you did, Parker. Throwing him into the door like that?"
"Brave? Hell, that was just stupid."
Lefty was now clambering slowly to his feet.
"Leave the security to the guards next time, Pete."
"Yeah, like you flat on your ass?"
Brian asked with a sneer. Javier's convulsing started getting worse. Peter also noticed he was sweating.
"Ambulance should be here in a minute,"
Lefty said, ignoring Brian.
"Figures that Velasquez is using as well as dealing. I kick his ass!"
Peter whirled around to see that Narice was back on his feet.
"Where the hell is he? I gonna kick?"
Even as he spoke, Peter had moved to intercept him faster than Brian or Lefty could have.
"Easy. Javier's already down. Get out of the way, teacher man. I gonna—"
Peter forcibly stopped Narice, putting his right hand on the boy's left shoulder and his left hand on the kid's right biceps, giving Peter a menacing look that probably would have scared most science teachers. Narice, who was bleeding from his outsized hooter, said,
"You best be letting go of me, teacher man."
"Javier's not going anywhere, Narice. Take a look."
He gestured with his head to the ground, where Javier was still twitching without actually taking his eye off Narice. Narice looked down at Javier.
"Damn."
He looked at Lefty.
"What'd you do to him?"
"He didn't do anything,"
Peter said quickly, before Lefty or Brian responded in kind.
"He just collapsed. Is he on anything that would do that?"
Narice just stared at Peter.
"You got 2 seconds to be letting go of me before I get up in your face."
Peter let go just as he heard sirens growing closer. Turning his back on Peter, Narice walked away.
"This ain't over,"
The ambulance pulled in behind one of the buses. Only then did Peter notice the crowd that had gathered, barely being held in check by a couple of faculty members and the other security guards, who'd come to check out the ruckus. One of the English teachers, a small woman named Constance Dobson, looked at Peter and shook her head.
The guard was right about what you did, you know.
Not sure which guard she meant, Peter asked. About being brave or about being stupid?
Both.
Unable to help it, Peter laughed. Yeah, maybe. Still, if I hadn't done anything.
Lefty or Brian would have taken care of it. Leave that to the pros, Parker.
I'll remember that, Peter lied. He'd stood by and done nothing when he had the power to help once. It was a mistake he would never make again. The EMTs started working on Javier, and based on their chatter, they were assuming he was coming down off a shot of ecstasy. Peter frowned. That doesn't track. He was straight in class. He had to have taken it after the bell rang. But you don't burn through an X-high that quick. But then, an X-high didn't turn you green and give you super strength.
Narice was right,
Peter thought, as he brushed off the paramedic who approached, assuring her that he was fine.
This isn't over.
2. An old saying had it that familiarity bred contempt, which explained why Eileen Velasquez hated Parkway Hospital so much. She'd certainly spent enough time here, and she'd come to despise the place. It all started when she was pregnant with her first child, Orlando. The pregnancy was deemed high risk by the doctors, and she spent the 4 months leading up to his birth checked into the OBGYN ward on 24-hour bed rest. She hadn't wanted another child after that, and she had talked her husband, Carlos, into letting her get one of those fancy birth control implants. Unfortunately, something about the implant didn't work right, and she became pregnant with Javier. That pregnancy went fine, though the labor took 23 hours, and she spent all 23 back here again. Somehow, Carlos talked her into a third child, which became 4 when her doctor told her she had twins, Jorge and Manuel. Then, Orlando got into that accident with his bike, necessitating an emergency room trip. Then Javier got into a fight at school, the first of many. Then they found out that Manuel had a bone disease, one not shared by Jorge. That meant lots more trips to and from not only Parkway Hospital, but also Mount Sinai in Manhattan to visit the specialist. And then there was the accident. Eileen worked at Dillmore, Ward, and Greenberger, attorneys at law, as a receptionist. It was there that she got the phone call from Mr. Harrington, the principal of Midtown High, saying there was an incident. Usually, that was code for Javier got into a fight, which it turned out was true again, as far as it went. But that Javier had been high on something was a new twist. She knew Javier had been dealing. She didn't know he was also taking. Mr. Ward, the managing partner, was completely okay with letting her go early. So she hopped on the V train and made the oh-so-familiar walk from the 71st Street station to the Parkway Hospital emergency room. The whiff of antiseptic mixed with sweat that characterized the hospital's ER filled her with an overwhelming feeling of disgust. She had hoped never to come back here again. Walking past the waiting area with its cracked and dirty plastic chairs, she proceeded to the long, high desk behind which sat a harried-looking white man in his 20s, wearing light blue scrubs, though he didn't seem to be a doctor or nurse. He didn't have the casual arrogance that every doctor Eileen had ever met carried, nor the seen-it-all look that most nurses had. The desk was at Eileen's neck level, and the receptionist was seated, so she had to peer down at him. The young man was on the phone.
Excuse me, Eileen said. Holding up a finger, the receptionist said,
No, Fred, we need them down here now. Yeah, I know they're backed up, but we got a serious situation here. It's 60 degrees out, Fred. We really don't need the AC on full blast. Look,
Excuse me, Eileen said a bit more forcefully. I need to see my son. Again, the receptionist held up a finger, this time mouthing the words, just a second.
Fred, I've got Doc Shannon crawling up my butt, and he ain't gonna leave there until this gets fixed. Can you please just send somebody? I don't even care if they fix it. Just have someone show up, okay? Thank you.
He hung up the phone and looked at Eileen.
Sorry about that. It's crazy here. Now who?
My son, Javier Velasquez.
Even as the receptionist started typing something onto his keyboard, the phone next to him rang again. He picked it up.
ER, yeah, 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 no, she's not on right now. No, she's not due back until tomorrow. Yeah, 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 I really don't know that. You'll have to ask her.
Really, ma'am?
You have to ask her.
Yeah, sorry.
Bye.
The receptionist let out a long breath.
Sorry about that. What's your husband's name again?
Through clenched teeth, Eileen said,
It's my son, Javier Velasquez.
Could you spell that, please?
Before she could, the phone rang again. He picked it up.
Hang on. ER.
Eileen was two steps shy of reaching down and yanking the phone out of the floor jack it was plugged into, when a voice from behind her said,
Excuse me, are you Javier's mother?
She turned to see another white man in his 20s, but this one had darker hair and a kinder face than the harried receptionist. He was dressed in a sports jacket, button-down shirt, and slacks. Nothing fancy. Nothing like her co-workers at Dillmore Ward. And obviously not a doctor or a detective. A teacher, maybe?
Yes, I'm Eileen Velasquez.
Hi, I'm Peter Parker. I'm Javier's science teacher.
I was right.
Were you the one? She hesitated.
I was the one who subdued your son. Kind of.
He smiled.
Actually, he pretty much subdued himself, and I happened to be standing closest. It was right after school was over, so I figured I'd come down, make sure he was okay.
I just got here.
She shook her head.
That was really nice of you, Mr. Parker. Thank you.
Call me Peter, and don't thank me yet. There's a detective from the 112th precinct here, and he's probably gonna want to talk to you. Not to mention the doctor. I've already spoken with both of them.
Did they tell you anything about Javier?
To her own ears, Eileen sounded like a woman desperate for news, which she supposed she was, even though a big part of her didn't want to know the answer.
Nothing I didn't already know. Looks like he took a hit of ecstasy, apparently, and then just went nuts. He hit one of the other kids and one of the guards, then jumped me before he collapsed into a pile of goo. Not literally,
he added quickly, though Eileen had assumed he was speaking figuratively. Though with the way the world is today, it wouldn't be the craziest thing I ever heard of.
Parker then said, Ms. Velasquez, I know Javier's had some problems, but I've never known him to take drugs before. Deal? Yes, but...
I don't know, Mr. Parker. Truth is, I don't know my son anymore. Javier's my second oldest. His older brother went off to college, and he's got two younger brothers, but...
She took a deep breath. One of them, Manuel, died a couple years ago, along with my husband. I'm sorry.
Parker sounded like he meant it, which Eileen appreciated.
And as I said, it's Peter.
Eileen didn't think it appropriate to refer to one of her son's teachers by his first name.
I wasn't really there for Javier much, especially after Manuel and Carlos died. I've got my hands full raising him and Jorge, and with the lawsuit,
she cut herself off. Parker didn't need to know about that.
Excuse me, Parker?
Parker turned around,
and Eileen followed his gaze. The speaker was a heavy-set black man in a dark suit, a shoulder holster bulging from under his pinstriped jacket, a gold-colored badge attached to his belt.
This must be the detective Mr. Parker was talking about.
Hi, Detective. Detective Pierce. This is Eileen Velasquez, Javier's mother.
Pierce's eyes widened.
Oh, yeah? Good. I need to talk to you, ma'am.
The detective removed a pad of paper from his inner jacket pocket and started flipping through it to a blank page, the paper making crinkling noises. I need to know what happened to my son.
The doctors are taking care of him, ma'am, but he'll be okay. Now I need to ask you.
I have to see my son, Eileen snapped. Parker said quickly, would it hurt to let her see Javier, detective? Pierce looked all put upon, but Eileen didn't care. Finally, he said,
yeah, okay, follow me.
The detective led them down one of the corridors to a room with four beds in it. Back here, the antiseptic smell was still strong, but the sweat was gone. She supposed out of the way of the craziness of the reception area, that was to be expected. Eileen didn't pay attention to the other three beds, focusing solely on the one closest to the door, where Javier lay sleeping.
That's the most peaceful I've ever seen him.
What's wrong with his skin? I've never seen him look so pale, she said after a second.
Actually, Parker said, that's an improvement. At his highest, he was green.
Green? This was the first Eileen was hearing about this. Why was he green? Excuse me? At the new voice, Eileen turned to see a young Asian woman standing in the doorway alongside a tall black man in a nurse's uniform. You people aren't supposed to be... Then she noticed Pierce. Oh, it's you. The kid's not waking up for a while yet, detective. There's no need...
Dr. Lee, this is Javier's mother.
Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. Velasquez. Nobody told me you were here. That's okay. Can you tell me what happened to my son? Mr. Parker here said it was ecstasy.
Not quite, Lee said. It's a new variant that's been hitting the streets, laced with gamma radiation, which is why they turn green when they get high. It's called Triple X on the street. He's lucky, though.
Eileen couldn't imagine how that could be.
What do you mean?
Your son's the fourth case I've seen in the last week. He's not showing any signs of radiation poisoning, which puts him one up on the other three. That means he's probably only taken it once or twice.
Pierce put a hand on Eileen's shoulder.
It took all of her willpower not to shove it off violently. Thanks, Doctor. Let me know when he wakes up, okay? Ms. Velasquez, if you'll come with me, I've got to ask you those questions now.
The detective led her out of the room. As they went, she heard the doctor say something quietly to the nurse. The nurse responded in a loud, deep voice.
Will do, doctor.
Once in the hallway, Eileen did shake off the detective's hand. I don't need you to push me, detective. I can walk on my own.
I'm sorry, ma'am, but I need...
I know what you need, so ask your questions so I can be with my son. She provided him with some basic information. Address, full name, her job, phone numbers where she could be reached, and so on. And then he asked about their family situation.
It's just me, Javier, and Jorge now. My oldest, Orlando, is at college in Florida. He doesn't come home anymore. Jorge's 9.
Anybody else? Husband?
My husband and Jorge's brother, Manuel, they died 2 years ago.
Were their deaths drug-related?
Eileen snapped again. What? You see a Latino family, you figure drugs right off?
Take it easy, Ms. Velasquez.
That was Parker. Eileen hadn't even heard him come out of Javier's room.
And detective, go light on her, will ya? This ain't your business, Parker. Javier's my student. That makes him my responsibility.
Pierce rolled his eyes.
What a load of crap. Look, unless you can tell me something new about Javier that you didn't tell me before.
I told you everything I know.
Fine, then shut the hell up. Ms. Velasquez, I'm trying to find out what happened to your son. Yeah, okay, maybe I jumped the gun with what I asked, but when you do what I do...
Eileen didn't care to hear the man's rationalization. My husband and son died in a car accident. Manuel had a bone disease, and we had to see a specialist in Manhattan. Carlos was driving him home after visiting that doctor, and a piece of concrete hit the car. It came from one of those superhero battles. Eileen had spent a long time in the emergency room after the car was totaled, hoping that Carlos and Manuel would awaken from their comas, knowing that they'd both probably be crippled for life even if they did survive. 3 days after the accident, Manuel died. Carlos's older, stronger body gave out another 4 days after that. Life had been a succession of nightmares since then. Jorge became sullen and uncommunicative without his twin brother. Javier's descent into criminality got worse, to the point of his being arrested more than once, though nothing that resulted in any kind of jail time. Orlando had gone off to college in Florida and refused to ever come home. Her subsequent wrongful death lawsuit against the Avengers, who had been fighting a group that called themselves the Wrecking Crew at the time Carlos and Manuel happened along, had been going on for some years now. Despite the lengthy interval, Eileen kept at it. Maybe if I hadn't kept at it so hard. She shook her head. So it didn't have anything to do with Javier, unless you think the Avengers gave him this triple X stuff.
Yeah, well, it wouldn't surprise me.
Pierce muttered.
What does that mean?
Parker asked.
Nothing. Look, I'm sorry, Ms. Velasquez, but I just need...
You've got everything you need, Eileen said, turning her back on the detective and heading toward the waiting area. To her relief, Pierce didn't follow. However, Parker did. Walking alongside her back to the front of the emergency room, he said, The guy was just trying to do his job.
What'll he do, Mr. Parker? Find out who did this to my son? He doesn't need to do that. I know who... It was me. I haven't been there for my son.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.